Hello everyone, in this video we will discuss about hereditary spherocytosis. Going to what is hereditary spherocytosis? It is a congenital disorder, it is a hemolytic disorder and is characterized by inherited defect in the red cell membrane which leads to formation of spherocytic red blood cell. Now this disorder is mostly autosomal dominant, however few cases of autosomal recessive are being seen. Also they are present in almost all races. However, higher prevalence is seen in European descent and in India it is mostly found in the northern region. Going to the etiopathogenesis, we will discuss about etiopathogenesis, then the clinical features, then the laboratory investigations. Firstly, the etiopathogenesis, normal red cell membrane is anchored to underlying skeleton. Now here we can see this is the normal red cell membrane, this is the lipid bilayer and this is the red cell cytoskeleton. Here the alpha and beta chains of spectrin which are part of cytoskeleton are joined by ankyrin protein to the band 3. This band 3 is present in the lipid bilayer. This is the first linkage. Second linkage is by protein 4.1 which joins the spectrin to the glycophorin C. Now, hereditary spherocytosis can be due to deficiency of any of these proteins. It can be due to deficiency of spectrin, ankyrin, band 3 or 4.1. However, the most common deficiency is the spectrin deficiency. Going to how the spectrin deficiency leads to formation of spherocytes. Now, deficiency of any of these will lead to weakening of the contact between the lipid bilayer and the underlying cytoskeleton. As a result, there are few areas of the lipid bilayer of the RBC which are now not directly supported by the underlying cytoskeleton. And because these are the weak areas, they are lost from the cells in the form of small lipid vesicles. This leads to decrease in the surface area of the red blood cell. This is relative to the volume of the RBC, which leads to formation of spherocytic red blood cells. The cell changes its shape from the biconcave to a spherocyte. Now spherocytes are being formed. How now spherocytes give rise to hemolysis? Now normally RBCs are less rigid, they are more deformable. However, the spherocytes, they are more rigid, they are less deformable. Because of this non-deformability, it prevents its passage from the spleen. Now, these spherocytic cells, they are retained in the splenic cords for a long time. Now, mostly spherocytes are destroyed there by reticuloendothelial system, that is the macrophages. Most of them are phagocytosed there, but few of them, they stay there and they face a unsuitable environment in a form of low glucose level, reduced pH. This metabolic deprivation of the red blood cell leads to more membrane loss. It increases the spherical shape of the red blood cells. Now, these red blood cells, few of them are again phagocytosed, but the remaining, they escape into the circulation and they appear as microspherocytes, which we can diagnose on the the blood films. Also, these, when they will enter in the second round into spleen, they will be again phagocytosed. This is how the hemolysis of the spherocytic red blood cells is going on and which leads to finally hemolytic anemia. Now going to the clinical features. The clinical features are of that of a hemolytic anemia. Majority of the patients, they present in childhood with a mild to moderate anemia. They have intermittent jaundice, they have enlarged spleen. Also history of any member of the family involved is mostly seen, but few of the patients, they do not present with a severe symptom. They are having a very mild symptoms and even incidental diagnosis can also be made, especially when we are investigating a patient who has gallstones. Gallstones, also pigment type of variety, is seen in the hemolytic anemia. Or a patient investigating, we investigate a patient of splenomegaly or having a very minimal anemia. So the clinical features can vary from patient to patient. Now going to the exacerbation of the symptoms, that is the crisis. The two types of crisis which are seen in case of hereditary spherocytosis, they are aplastic crisis and the hemolytic crisis. In aplastic crisis, when such person it gets infected by a parvovirus, mostly which is the cause of aplastic crisis, this leads to temporary aplasia of the erythroid precursors and leads to sudden worsening of the symptoms, because already hemolysis was going on and now second hit is by temporary aplasia of the erythroid precursors. Second is the hemolytic crisis. This is due to infection, any infection which leads to hyperplasia of the macrophage system. Now increase in the macrophages will lead to increased hemolysis and leading to hemolytic crisis. Going to the laboratory investigations. In the laboratory investigations, we will examine the peripheral blood of the person. We will look for hemoglobin. Hemoglobin will be low. The anemia will be mild to moderate. We will go for RBC indices, in which the MCHC will be increased in this case. MCH will be normal and MCV will be slightly low. We will understand this better when I will discuss the investigations of the hemolytic anemia, which I will discuss in a separate video. Also, reticulocytosis is present in hemolytic anemia. Now, on the red blood, in the peripheral blood smear, the most characteristic finding is presence of spherocytes. Now, what are spherocytes? Spherocyte is a red blood cell which is smaller in the size. It doesn't have a central pallor and is hyperchromic. Now, here we can see this is a spherocyte. We can see, we can compare it with small lymphocyte, because a small lymphocyte has an equivalent size as that of a normal red blood cell. Now small lymphocyte, we can see this is a small cell, it has no central pallor and is also hyperchromic. This is a characteristic spherocyte. Now going to other investigations which can be done, it can be bone marrow examination can be done, which shows erythroid hyperplasia, osmotic fragility test. Now this test is commonly employed screening test for hereditary spherocytosis, because the spherocytic red blood cell, they are osmotically fragile. So here we can see this is the spherocytic red blood cells and they get to lyse. We can see the lyses of the spherocytic red blood cells, it is seen here. However, the normal red blood cells, they lyse at a lower concentration. They start lysing at a higher concentration. Now other tests which can be done for a hereditary spherocytosis, they are autohemolysis test. There is a test known as estify glycerolysis time. Also we can directly identify any deficient cytoskeletal protein like spectrin and chirin. We can directly identify it. We will discuss all these investigations in a separate video, because it's a long topic to discuss over here. Now lastly, going to the treatment. Mostly the treatment is symptomatic in the form of folate and B12 supplementation, but in the case of severe hereditary spherocytosis, we go for splenectomy, because splenectomy, it corrects the hemolysis which is going on and also it prevents complications such as gallstones, jaundice. But the splenectomy comes with its own disadvantage. It leads to increased risk of sepsis from pneumococci, from other encapsulated bacteria. Therefore, mostly before splenectomy, immunization of against pneumococcal bacteria is done. This was all about the hereditary spherocytosis. Do like, share and subscribe to this channel if you like these videos. Thanks for watching this.